introduce first Michael Bulger, and he's going to go over one of the programs of Operation 36. And Michael, take a second. Thanks.
All right, so Kirk, James, I want to thank you for having me here today. What I thought I'd do is just kind of tell you a little bit about what we do at Patterson. I just wrapped up my ninth year there, and just by a show of hands, how many folks actually teach juniors at their clubs or have programs? Okay. Any of those programs on track to grow six figures? Okay, awesome. All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you what we did before Operation 36, and then how that's kind of benefit bringing on that program to just add another layer into our junior program. So I'll go ahead and get started here. So what are the challenges when we first meet the golf course? Well, you know, for us, you know, par fours, par fives, those are pretty straightforward. You know, we're going to be on the green in two or three shots and then have one or two putts. But for the beginner, that experience is something that's a little bit different. So this is kind of how their experience goes. Is instead of playing from a spot closer to the green, they start from one of the back tee boxes. And their drive misses the fairway, ends up in the rough, and they just play army golf until they get up to the green. And then that's where the trouble begins, because now there's bunkers. They might end up in one, two or three shots later, they're on the green. And then once they get on the green, they've got three or four putts. And finally, they're in the hole in 10 shots or more. So I don't know if anyone's ever experienced that before, but I have. And one of the most frustrating things is, when I'm talking with parents, when they take the kids out to play, they're playing from their parents to the tee box instead of a tee box, which is a little bit more in line with what their skill set is. So not only is it frustrating with the score that you get, but you're actually on track to play. You're going to average about 23 minutes a hole, and instead of playing 9 holes in 2 hours or less, you're looking at about 3.5 hours. So, what is Operation 36? Well, Operation 36 actually believes in working from the green back to the tee box. Okay, so what they do is they start everybody out at 25 yards. That's Division 1. And there's going to be 6 divisions all together, working all the way back to the tee box. But you gotta be pretty good at putting and chipping to shoot 36 or less from there. Once you can shoot 36 or less, you're gonna move back to 50 yards, then 100, 150, 200, and then eventually your forward tee box with the adult tees. So at Patterson, we have 4 different colors. We have the green tees, which a lot of our ladies play from. We have a white tee box, we have a blue tee box, and then eventually the black. Okay. But I also like to share with you is maybe a few examples of some of our kids. And if you're not already running Operation 36, maybe some of the things you'll see as a coach. So what we do is we actually go out with the kids when they play their matches. And we're lucky enough to have our matches every Wednesday after school. So the coaches will go out there, we'll serve as markers, and then that allows the kids to kind of learn how to keep score and also kind of see where they stand in a good tournament environment. But here's one of our students. This is Will. And Will was probably what you'll see a lot of our students do is he's just a steady progression. So he doesn't necessarily pass his division on the first try, but it'll take him a few tries to eventually kind of move on to that next division. So for example, in Division 1, Will's first time he ever played from 25 yards was a 41. And just like the stock markets, these scores can kind of go up and down from week to week, maybe depending on what's going on at home, what's going on at school. But once he passed that with that 35, now he moved back to that next division, which was from 50 yards. And again, that number we tend to see kind of goes up when they move back a set of tee boxes. Not only is it because they're going back to a little bit further distance, but now, like course strategy kind of becomes a little bit more important. So we've got bunkers around a few of our greens that protect that opening, and we'll be able to allow those bunkers that first week. But what's neat is that allows us as a coach to have those conversations with our players to see, hey, how did you go out there? You know, what went well? What are some things that you could work on? And what did you struggle with out there that we could work on for next week to maybe make that better. And so after that 61, he mentioned, hey, I hit it into the bunkers a lot. And so we had a chance to then work with him, you know, in a group or even in private lessons to help with those bunker shots. And eventually, a few weeks later, he passed that. And now he's on a Division III, which is 100 yards. And, you know, Will's 9 years old, so this is pretty darn good for a nine-year-old. He just had a couple scores from there because our fall season kind of wrapped up. But, you know, he was kind of up and down there from 100 yards. Our next student is going to be one of a little bit older student here. This is Michael. And Michael was, we have a few students like him who actually, they usually get past their divisions in the first try or two. And then what he's found himself is he's found himself kind of at what we call, whoops, his challenge point. Has anyone heard that concept before? Challenge point. So what it is basically, it's an area where maybe your skill set isn't exactly as high as you'd like it to be, but to get to that next level, we're gonna kind of stress that environment for you where you can kind of push through it. So again, Michael's a little bit older. He's actually 12 years old, and he passed Division 1 and 2 fairly quickly. Division 3 had a little bit of trouble again. That's where we talked a little about course management. Bunkers we see also kind of come into play once you get around that 50 or 100 yard mark. And now he's on Division 4, so he's playing from 150 yards. And then he's trying to figure out, hey, how can I stay out of trouble, but also get in the green in regulation, and then have it come down to your putter. That kind of makes a difference as to whether or not you pass. So he's kind of been fluctuating anywhere from like the low 50s to the mid 40s. And at the end of the season, he actually came down and shot us those at 40 on his last round. So it's kind of exciting to see what will happen next spring. Third example is Chase. Chase is actually, he was 6 years old when I started working with him. And he's actually 7 years old. He's 7 years old this year. And Chase was kind of unique. What happened to him was he passed both his divisions one and two, like right out of the gate. And it's pretty incredible for a 6 or 7 year old to be doing that. But what happened was, I almost wish he hadn't done that because he kind of got stuck there at division three or 100 yards. So again, not bad for a 7 year old, but you know, we've had talks with his parents as far as, hey, is there a week you might want to go back to a 25 or 50 yard just to kind of brush up on some putting, on some chipping, on some pitching. But again, with Chase, as we see from a lot of 100 yarders, those folks tend to have, we need to have those conversations with course management. Chase was someone who loved to hit his driver and hits it pretty darn good for a 7 year old. I mean, he can hit it over 100 yards, and that tended to get him in trouble. So there's a few holes where he picked out, hey, use the driver on these holes. On these holes, let's go ahead and maybe just hit off with like a 7 iron or 6 iron to get you in play, and then knock it on the green on your second shot, and then go in that putting. So Chase did a great job, kind of came down there towards the end where he actually recorded two scores, 40 and 40 back-to-back weeks. And I think it's just a matter of some development, letting, you know, just let some time take place. But he's been on Division III for over a year now, okay? But the coolest thing is he wants to prove me as a coach wrong that he can go just like he did through Division I and II, past those. But, you know, I had a talk with his parents. I said, as soon as I saw that happen, I thought he's going to struggle at Division III for a little while. So it's good for him. I think he's building some resilience, some grit, and hopefully he can pass that here this next year. Any questions so far? Yes?
In the Division III, all those rounds up, who takes him out for that? Go out by himself to his parents?
Yeah, so what we've been doing is, we've been doing it as coaches, we've been taking them out. So I'll kind of go over a little bit about how we run those matches and how the coaches do it, but we kind of wait till everyone's in season when we're getting our interns coming in early May before we start some of those matches. But we kind of utilize Operation 36, maybe not straight to the tee like they do it. We kind of, you know, take some things from it, but we as coaches are going out there and actually marking the kids. Yeah. Did you have a question too?
It was along the same lines.
Okay.
Okay, so how do we progress the golfers here? Well, what they've come up with is, just like there's six different divisions that you can pass, what we're gonna do is we're gonna have 12 different subjects. So over that, you just multiply those together, you're gonna have 72 different objectives that you can go over with the kids. Now, what they did in the past was, with those 72 objectives, that's something you would kind of follow along with the kids. Going forward, actually what they're going to be doing is they've actually taken ownership of their app. A few years ago when they first came out, they were outsourcing that. But now they've got full control of that, and you're actually going to be able to customize that. So let's say, for example, there might be some situations where you like the curriculum, but you also want to give your student maybe some extra objectives or extra things to work on. You're going to be able to design that yourself and then let that student work on that, just as if it was an objective. What I like about what they've done is, actually they've done a really good job with just gamifying the whole situation. All right, so what they've got is, with those objectives, we'll cover those in classes, and then you get tested on those. And that lets us know whether you've mastered that subject material. We've also used their bag tag, and what you'll see is, at the top, there's gonna be the divisions 1, 2, and 3, and then that is gonna be reserved for the objectives. So once you pass those 12 objectives for each level, you're gonna get a color sticker to show that you've mastered that. At the bottom, you've got the number. So that's just showing, hey, what is your best or record score from each of those divisions? One thing that I thought was interesting is, I thought a lot of kids might want to try and beat their best score from each division, but what we found out, at least in the first 2 years, is a lot of the juniors, once they pass, like, they just wanna go to the next level. So there's a little bit of competitiveness there with the kids, which is good. And it's kind of neat when you see one of their friends pass. It's not too often where, like, the kids, where their friends pass, they wanna get up to their friend's level. So they kind of put in the extra effort and take that next step. So, what is it based on? Basically, they've got three pillars. Basically, I just like to explain, it's coaching, training, and then also playing. So what's nice is, in the coaching part of it, we have classes set aside literally Tuesday through Saturday where the kids can come in. We usually keep those to around an hour, and we'll cover one or two different subjects. Training, we also set up a supervised practice, so if someone wants a little bit more help and they want it in that group session versus like one-on-one, what we'll do is we'll set aside like an hour, usually on the weekend, where they can come in and get a little bit more time, work on their thing. And then I think the most important thing, whether you decide, hey, you know what, Operation 36 might be something that we want to look and add to our programming, is adding this playing part of it. So what's neat is you get to measure the kids and how they do in kind of a tournament-like environment. I don't know how many of us have ever had classes where we just have kids hit ball after ball. I used to be that way a long, long time ago. And what I love about what Operation 36 has done is it's provided a platform where we can kind of see, hey, what we're covering in class, how does that transfer into the course? And then what can we do better in our classes to help the kids move along a lot quicker there in the course? So those are the three pillars it's kind of built on. Again, we run our Operation 36 matches on Wednesdays. And then in addition to some of, they started off kind of with juniors, they're also expanding a little bit more to our adult programming. So some of us might have some ladies programs here. Did you have a question?
Yeah, you said you run classes Tuesday through Saturday. How many kids do you get in your classes, and what are the age ranges?
Yeah, so we teach as young as 4 years old.
Okay.
We go all the way up to high school. We tend to keep the same age groups back to back. So say, for example, if I had a Tuesday class after school from 4 to 5, that 5 to 6 would also be the same age group. I've experimented with age groups, but I tend to like 7 to 10 in one group, and then 9 to 14 in another. And then we also have a little bit older group, 13 and up. And then we do a tinier class, 4 to 6 years old.
So you'll have separate sessions set up for those age groups.
Correct.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. We'll keep our student-teacher ratio 6 to 1, and then max class at about 12.
Yeah.
So again, they've kind of gone and evolved into more of adult programming. This here's an example of one of the facilities that utilizes it with the ladies. And they've got 4 semesters set up of 8-week sessions. But again, kind of utilizing the same philosophy of classes, supervised practice, and then also the matches. At Patterson, again, this is just one way that we've kind of layered some more junior programming into the thing. When I came on board 9 years ago, I was hired as the first assistant. I love to do a lot of teaching, but I had a lot of operational things on my plate. So some of you might have assistants that kind of are in the same boat. And what's nice is it's literally just provided a turnkey operation for us. You know, you might be going helter-skelter in the merchandising or getting the tournament ready, but then you can slip right into a class because you've got lesson plans that are developed for you, you've got the marketing behind you, and you've got a system in place, which literally you just have to execute. But this is how we do it here at Patterson. We're actually on track to do 6 figures with Operation 36 next year, but this will be our second program that actually does over 6 figures with regards to junior golf. And what we've got is taking their platform with the classes, supervised practice, as well as the matches. We also have a summer camp which runs 7 weeks called the Panther Camp. That involves not only golf and tennis, but also swimming, arts and crafts, things like that. And then we also have golf and tennis camps. So that is strictly golf and tennis, runs 9 to 3, Monday through Friday. We've got 5 of those sprinkled kind of throughout the year, 1 in April, 2 in June, and then a couple in August right before they go back to school. Another thing we also like to take advantage of are golf and actually junior golf days. So if there's any holidays in your area where the kids get off for school, we try and take advantage of offering something either for 3 hours or 6 hours that day where the moms can drop off the kids and then pick them up later this afternoon.
Do you have a question? Just costs. What's the number of costs here for a child or to run through the program?
Yeah, so it just kind of depends on the semester. So in the spring and fall, what we do is we just make it kind of an all-in deal, but they average about $37.50 a class. Over like spring and fall, we'll have roughly about 10 weeks. We'll have roughly a 10-week period. If that kind of helps answer your question there. So I want to thank you for everyone's time, and if you have any questions, we'll be more than happy to answer them.
Sure. My first question is to run an Operation 36, do you have to become a certified instructor? Do you need training? Do you have to pay an annual fee? And any of those costs to utilize this program?
Yeah, so when I went through the program 2 years ago, I kind of got on the ground floor and they offered a 2-day training. And that was down there in North Carolina where both Matt and Ryan are based out of. They have now kind of an onboarding system online, and that's just as effective as what we covered as far as the material 2 years ago.
What are the general costs?
The general costs, for a year, I believe it's now $3,600, and for 6 months, it's $2,400. But what's neat is those guys are going to show you how to actually raise the money to cover that expense. So it's not like, oh man, I got to put out a couple $1,000s. They're going to show you how to build that into the packaging, where that's just part of what you raise to cover that stuff. You know, just like as if we've got matches, there's going to be other things associated with building out those programs and recognizing folks with different rewards, if you will. Makes sense. Yes?
How many instructors do you have working with you like for all these different sessions?
Yeah, so our Our staffing model changes from year to year, kind of based on the budget we've been doing. This last year we had four interns with us, which is the most we've had, but we also lost an assistant. So we used to have four assistants who would help with this, and now we're down to three assistants plus four interns. So we kind of rotate that as far as who's available to help. But again, this isn't the only program we have. We've got other things that we have to cover, so sometimes we've got staff in two different places at the same time.
Any other questions? How many kids end up on the golf course on like a Wednesday during the matches?
Yeah, so each semester is a little different. In the spring, we'll be right around this last spring. So we had 76 juniors in this spring, and out of the 76 that come in class, we had maybe just under 20 that would play in the matches.
Are they playing the full nine, or are they playing like some holes twice?
You know, so they're playing the full nine, and we've been fortunate enough to actually have Wednesdays blocked off. And what we'll do is we'll do like a shotgun start, and then what we'll do is we'll go out there with the coaches and the kids, and then we just zoom around. And what's nice is we actually play those matches anywhere from 60 to 90 minutes. That's how long it takes. So we're probably averaging around 75 minutes. It helps that we have a cart,
yeah,
but again, we're playing from 25 yards. It's like chip, putt, putt, you know? So those things go pretty quick. Now after 2 years, we're kind of finding, hey, now a lot of the juniors are kind of reaching their challenge point where, you know, as I showed some examples, they might be in there for, you know, a semester or two. But then we also have new kids too, which are coming to the program and they shoot 25, they keep moving on as well, a little quicker.
Do you ever find the staffing challenging in the sense that, you know, you're doing your supervised practice and plus your camps and other things that you got going on, and then the time on the golf course? You know, I mean, it sounds like you got a decent amount of staff, but nonetheless, midsummer, you guys, it sounds also like your membership is accommodating too with the golf course, which.
Yeah, I mean we're a family club, and it seems like it's just getting a little bit younger each and every day. So I know everyone's situation is completely different. Yes, it's very challenging. You know, one thing that I like is they've done a lot of the grunt work for you, but there's still a lot of administrative and follow up with this program. So that's kind of taking me a little bit off of the lesson tee, if you will. But what's nice is you're leveraging the time that you're actually out of the lesson team. So, you know, there's some programs with Operation 36 where our hourly rate is anywhere from $225 to $500 an hour. And, you know, in order to do that, I have to give a couple hours worth of lessons. So I think kind of it works out.
Parent feedback is good. The members love it.
Yeah, parents love it. You know, I've had a few ladies, I've introduced some of the ladies to the concept. I don't necessarily run it as, you know, this is an Operation 36 ladies program, but they've been very open to it. And I think what it does is it just opens your eyes. You know, as a coach, the students will experience what they're really bad at. And, you know, it just hits you right in the face. So from there, as a coach, you're not telling them what you have to do. They actually tell themselves what they need to work on in order to get better. But, you know, a lot of our folks, what I found is they still like playing from the back tees, you know, and it is what it is. But I think the more that we can help educate, I think it's going to be better in the long run. And just like any junior program, I mean, we started with nothing. And in 5 years, it's now, you know, doing the numbers that it's doing. And hopefully it continues to keep doing that. Yes.
The on-course days, how many days a week do you do that?
We just do it one day a week. It's Wednesdays. So what we'll do is we'll do an hour class from 4 to 5. That's with more of my advanced kids. So I actually put that in place just because now the parent can drop the kids off at 4 o'clock with us in class for an hour. And then from 5 to 7, we run the match. So we'll do the 9 holes with the kids. We'll come in, we'll have pizza, we'll have refreshments. And so it's a way to kind of have them bond as well and kind of build that camaraderie. So those are every Wednesdays from 5 to 7. In the the summer, we usually go a little bit earlier. We'll go 4 to 6 because during the season, we'll have pasta night at the club. And that usually starts around 6 o'clock. So once they're coming off the course, we might have a bite or two of pizza with us, and then they're going with the parents to pasta night.
The coaching and the training and the matches are all like come in one price, right? So, or is there a different segment price?
Yeah, so it's going to be the same price when we're writing the hour, and then I've got a couple classes that I'll do for an hour and a half or 2 hours that are a little bit more expensive. But again, those are the older kids. Those are kids that are, you know, junior high or actually playing on their high school teams, where we spend a little more time with them. Yeah, whether you're 7 years old or, you know, 9 or 12 years old, if you're in the Operation 36, the hour class is the same price. So what's nice is, you know, if you're coming every Tuesday at 4 o'clock, but maybe one Tuesday you can't make, we'll try and slide you into another class that week as long as there's availability. Right now our programs, you know, we got a couple of classes that are sold out, but we're not sold out every single class. So usually there's that flexibility to kind of squeeze an extra player too if they need a, you know, quote unquote makeup a day. We don't really have makeups, but, you know, we're gonna be covering the same material and objective that week with all the classes. It's just a matter of whether or not they're in that first division, second division, or if they're a little bit further up with regards to the subjects that we cover.
So that your program is very extensive, lots of players, lots of other things. How does that work with what goes on at the country club? Your tournament schedule for men and ladies, or with, you know, your outing schedule, how does that all blend in?
Very carefully.
Obviously.
Yeah, so you know, a few years back, I mean, we're keeping track of like how many events we actually prepare for, and I don't know if this number is still the same, but at that time it was 116. And that was whether you're doing a scorecard, maybe you know, a scoreboard, rule sheet, anything that had to do with prepping an event. Like we'd go over, we have over 116 events, and that's a lot. And so, you know, what we're very careful of is exactly with staffing. Like where can we potentially have, you know, 3 or 4 events going on that is going to really kind of deplete our staff. So we've been super, super careful with that. But we've got a lot going on at the Patterson Club. We've got anywhere from 19 to 22,000 rounds a year, and it just seems like we're adding more and more programming. But one thing I've been trying to do that's, or try to be careful of, is not only pay attention to what else is going on at the club, but how can we drive other parts of the club, right? So if they're coming and spending more time at Patterson, how's that gonna affect our food and beverage operation? You know, how's that going to affect their experience, and are they going to stay at the club a lot longer? Again, some of those metrics are really nice where, you know, if you're trying to explain your value to a club, that's a great way to kind of show it. And again, there's a lot of other metrics that you can kind of come up with just to show your value there at the club. But, you know, a few years ago when I came to the section was when we were going through that recession there in 07, 08, and 09. We talked a lot about how to show value. Well, this is a great way, not only run these programs, but document what you're doing. Super, super important. Any other questions? Well, thank you.
All right. All right, great. Thank you, Michael. It's great information. And it's really nice to see, you know, looked at that, how many different junior programs they have. We got Operation 36, they have the junior camps, golf and tennis, you know, etc. So it's probably pretty difficult to do, but the benefits are great because the facility is bringing in revenue, the golf instructors are making money. So it's great. Thank you so much. All right, next we have James Honk.
Anybody want to go run to the restroom first?
Anything like that? We'll talk to you. Let me see. How's your program? No, well, why don't you get started?
Sorry.
We'll play backfield. And then, yeah, we'll plan on probably taking just a small break, maybe around 11 o'clock. So, James, we'll leave it up to you. James, on.
So, you can see what I'm going to obviously talk about also is junior golf development here. And now, what's interesting about what you're hearing about is Michael's talking from the private club perspective, and this is a public facility. So the numbers are going to be different, obviously, but I think it's good for you all to see what the differences are, see if maybe there's some things you can take back to your club, if it's a private club, and maybe implement them as well. So let me kind of give you a little history here. So in 2003, that was my first year here. By the way, all these numbers, they're public, so don't worry about this. 297 juniors total for the year. So that included the spring, the summer, the fall camps that we would have here. It also included private lessons. And at the end of the year, the general manager at the time called me in the office about how the year go. It was good. So you think a lot of things could be changed? And I said, yeah, I think some things could be done differently. Because they had brought me in from another junior program. I said, well, let's blow it up. Let's start all over. So going into 2016, we had 366 juniors show up in the summer programs alone. 497 if you count repeating. So people were coming more than once. We've had a few people come 5 times, 10 times. Talking summer programs here. On top of that, 468 junior lessons. That's half hour lessons, 1 hour lessons, playing lessons. So obviously you can see the numbers are going up and up and up. Fall of 2016, our 6-week PAR program, which is for beginners, 65 kids enrolled. Very next season, spring 2007, same program, 76. So it's constantly growing. Word of mouth, so to speak. And here's another number. So except for 7 juniors that you saw in all those numbers that I gave, none were my students. That was all the other 4 teachers on staff. So for my programs that I run, Birdie and Eagle programs, remember the beginners are PAR programs? You get it? Birdie and PAR. Elite competitive juniors, private lessons, 524, on top of what you saw. So I know sometimes the question is asked, over the past 10 years, where have we seen the greatest advancements in teaching? Could be technology, right? Launch monitors, could be 3D motion capture, biomechanics. For me, the greatest advancements in teaching have been in junior golf. And so one of the things that I've decided to dedicate my life to is this advantage should be for all of us, not just a few of us. So how many of you are at private clubs? And how many of you are at public facilities? Okay. So this is something, so if you're at a private club, you can offer to your membership something what Operation 36 is showing. Great program. So what was junior golf? To be, the kid would just stand there, someone would bring their kid. You dump the basketballs out, give them a club, maybe grandpa's cut down clubs. Say, go ahead, hit. Show me what you got. Stand this way, hold the club that way. Club's too heavy, too long. You know, the funny thing about this video, this is Madison. She's 8 years old in this video. That's my 7-iron. She hits it better than me. Same height. So it fits her perfectly. We videotaped this probably 7 times, and I kept telling her, no, you got to hit the ball bad for the video. She was actually hitting it pretty good. So basically, that was what junior golf lessons were like. So what junior golf has become? Developmental programs. So you have long-term development, TPI. Some of you might be aware of the Canadian National Program models. They're based off of TPI, long-term development. You have fitness protocols, skills acquisition, self-discovery, focus on multiple sports, cross-referencing. This is a big one, something that Michael was bringing up. What I've discovered is 50-50 minimum percentage on the practice facility, on the golf course. The biggest draw that we have in the area is we put them on the golf course. So we have an 18-hole championship course, which you see there. We also have a 9-hole executive course down the road. So we can put them, depending on what's available. We also will book tee times, just like the consumer will. Technology for the kids. Mental approach, focus band, or Muse. Swing instruction is no longer 95% of junior golf teaching. That's a big one. So if you're using the traditional model of you're just giving private lessons to kids and you're standing on your club's range and you're doing that, what's going to happen is there the parents will start to wonder, when do they get out on the golf course? When are they going to get out? So one of the things that parents are searching for is programs where they get to be out on the course as soon as possible. Some of you probably, or if all of you probably know, when you're playing sports, what happens? We're right on the course. If a couple of kids never played basketball before, we're not going to be off in the corner doing drills. We're immediately going to go, we're going to start playing. Better yet, what's probably going to happen is I'm going to look for a friend of mine that's pretty decent at basketball and say, hey, can you show me what to do? Yeah, come on, let's go to the basketball court. We're on the court. So that's a big draw for programs. So a little insight into the PAR program. So fitness. Especially in the summer, this is from the summer, every day's program starts this way. Putting, making it a little bit more gamified for the kids. Remember, most of these kids are beginners, so just giving them an idea. So what'll happen, I'll pause this for a second, if I can. So the idea here is just giving the kids a perception of what you want them to do. It doesn't have to be picture perfect. I bring up playing basketball. I might be shooting at the hoop for an hour and not make one basket, but you know, I'm sitting there going, oh, that's fun, okay. Right. So same thing here, it's, I'm not standing in there, and neither are any of the instructors going, no, your feet have to be shoulder width apart, and remember, you've got to have a soft grip. It's kind of, do we keep the instruction minimal, short term, because, right, you only have a short attention span, and what our goal is, and I'll bring it up again later, is we give them something like this, and then what we do is so that's the instruction part, and sometimes we'll go to each kid, give them a little bit of help. Then what we do is we turn this into a game. We play a game that does this, that focuses on what we talked about. And then we'll be on the golf course. May not be the same day, but it will be during that week. Or during, if it's a 6-week program, somewhere there. So you can see here they're doing some chipping, some pitching. They have targets out there. So here, they're just working on their swing right to the golf course. So in a typical summer program, which is 4 days long or 5 days long, Monday to Friday or Tuesday to Friday, depending on the age group, is we'll do this. So what'll happen is Monday and Tuesday, for instance, for the older kids, will be drills, games, instruction. And then Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, we're out on the executive course. And we kind of do similar to what Operation 36 is. We might start up 25 yards, 50 yards from the hole, depending on the age group. And then kind of work our way back. So on the first hole, we might start from 25 yards. Let's see what you get. Then the next hole, we might do it from 35, 40 yards. Then the next hole, we might do it from 50 yards, 75 yards. And then the kids are in the carts, the people movers going like, well, what are those? Well, those are tee boxes. We're probably going to be there sometime on Friday. So we're kind of like taking Operation 36 and scrunching it all into 2 days. Fitness. Again, this is a little bit more advanced program, obviously. Now what's happening here, especially for the kids that are starting to get a little bit more serious about the game, is understanding that fitness is a component. It's part of it. So this girl, Victoria, she may quit tomorrow for all I know and never touch a golf club again. But if she takes up another sport, soccer, tennis, whatever it is, she's going to be carrying that over. Oh yeah, it's just like golf. Also, what we're doing is making a lifestyle change for the kids, and the parents love this. We're making fitness a part of their lives. So she's 9 or 10 now. If she keeps doing this, 14 years old, she's thinking of working out, right? It's part of her life.
How many adults request you go into the same program or similar? A lot. Looks fun.
Yeah. In fact,
I didn't see anything.
So going a little bit more specifically into things, here's putting. So we set up the putting green. There's a couple of things. None of the stuff is stuff that is revolutionary. We set up tees for gates. Over there, 5 balls at a spot, so with discs, right, to the alignment sticks for speed control, and there's tees in the ground every 3 feet, something like that, 5 balls. Basically set something up similar here. So just giving you an idea of what we do, and then kids are doing it. Beginner. Intermediate level. And again, I'm just giving you an idea of like one of the games or drills we would do. Right? You could come up with 20 for each one, 30. Chipping. So basically, just setting it up. Notice there's 3 different areas. These are landing areas. So just getting an idea, they can rotate around. Each one of those shag bags has 15, 20 balls. Well, they're working on short game, landing area, controlling it, visualizing it. So there's Madison again. There's Brianna, beginner. Chloe, intermediate. Normally, we would jump in there. No, you gotta be on your front foot. You might not want to do that, because in that, when I was videotaping, I was about ready to put my camera down, my phone down, and go like, no, I want you to be looking, and I realized, she just hit 5 in a row, really nice, soft ones. And who am I to go in there and break that? Because I might say, do it this way, and then she can't hit a ball. So sometimes you have to police yourself as a teacher. It's like, we'll fix that a little bit later, but right now, she's really happy with this nice, high, soft chip shot that she's hit. So we have one of our target greens set up like a dartboard, so you can see the points. And we can set it up at different distances, 30 yards, 50 yards, 20 yards, whatever it is for the kids. And we can do this individually. So here, we have a kid here who's been playing for a couple of years, so he's figuring out points. We can also do it as a team concept, right? First team that gets to 100 points wins ice cream in the snack bar. Everyone gets this or everyone gets that. prepare them for the golf course, scoring. So chipping, for instance, here. Cones are set up at different distances. There's four balls there. Telling them about landing area. Remember the other one where you saw the white dividers and they were chipping over? Now they're transferring it to the green. They're actually going like they're playing. So again, this is from about 10, 15 yards from our practice green. This is Ryan, he's 6 years old. Hate the kid. Played in two U.S. kids golf tournaments. He shot even par in one and minus four in the other. Can't stand it.
How about drive chip putt? Where he wasn't old enough.
You know what happened? He had one more putt, and all he had to do was get it in whatever, and he would have qualified. And I think he just had a brain fart, blew it off the green. He was upset. So full swing. And really, what I'm trying to do with each one of these spots is give the kids a purpose. Right? One of the things that we see is everybody always wants to be told what to do. There's an app to solve every problem. What do I do? What happened there? So what we're doing is just trying to give them a problem to solve. So here, Catherine, what you can see there is the two foam noodles. So the original goal was, can you hit it between them? Right? She changed it to, and this is her. Well, if I hit a draw, I should be hitting it at the right one, and if I hit a fade, I should be hitting at the left one. This is a 9-year-old girl that figured that out. So in that video, she's trying to hit the right one. So they can figure it out once you open this up.
So for a girl like that, you're starting to teach her how to work the ball. Is she doing that on her own, or are you introducing
It's kind of both. It's interesting. Like I said earlier about sometimes we want to jump in there and fix it. It's sometimes if you stand back and just kind of watch it, let it happen, you start to see very interesting things happen in terms of what the kids are doing. They start learning how to work the ball. One thing that I did on a side note is on the range is face control, right? Start the ball to the right. Hit this ball, start the ball to the right. Okay, this next ball started to the left. To the right, left, right, left. Okay, now hit one. I never say middle or straight, I always say in between. And it's amazing how when they go right, left, it's like right, left, right, left, right, left. They autocorrect. And then they hit in the middle and they kind of look at you like, you know what I was supposed to do? You know, sometimes I'm sitting there with kids going like, shit, pretty good. I'm sorry. Like that. And what they start to do, some of the older kids, not the younger kids, but the older kids, what will happen is when they start going right, left, they start asking questions like, if I started to the right, wouldn't that lead to a draw? Yeah. Okay. And then about five swings later, you start seeing likewise this. Or what they'll do is they'll push it out to the right, and it'll be a fade. Is that bad? No, it's a push fade. Freddie Couples push fades. So maybe you just aim left. There's a whole bunch of variables, right? Oh, it's just giving him another problem to solve. We like to end a lot of the practices with competition. So again, this is just one of the summer camps. So we call this the great race. Sometimes we'll start them up close to the green, sometimes we'll start them way over 30 yards away. It's like a relay race. All of their putters are on the ground, they run up, they get a ball, and they putt. Start doing this stuff, you've got their, they got, now their attention is caught because they lost the game. Or they won the game and they want to keep winning. Or if they lost the game, why did I lose the game? So that game that we played, guess what we were practicing 5 minutes earlier? Speed. So the game is always reinforcing what we were teaching. So they come back the next day or the next week if it's a spring or fall program. Hey, James, are we going to play that great race thing again? See, they were thinking about it. Are we going to play that again? Yeah, it was fun. Can we play it again? Yeah, sure. But what did you learn from it? I got to work on speed. Speed? Yeah, speed. Yeah, I got to work on speed. Right? So they're setting the outline for the day's practice sometimes. So on the course, skills transference. Basically, like I said earlier, sometimes we're setting up the course just like what we were doing on the range. Self-discovery. I'll always ask questions, what do you think happened there? Right? What did we talk about earlier? What do you think happened? It's okay if you don't know. Try and remember. Don't worry about failure. Failure into learning. Enjoy the experience. Enjoy the challenge. Right? It's not about like, man, I suck. So I put this in here, this was earlier. So you see this. So this is the balance game. So basically what happens, they all have their pile of balls and we set up and I say, ready, set, go. The idea is just work on your balance. Can you hold the finish? I don't care if you hit a good shot or not, I just, can you hold the finish? Now I know there's some thoughts out there about like, do good players really hold their finishes, right? This is not about being a good player. This is about being athletic. Are you coordinated enough to hold your finish, to be balanced? That's all. Right? I'm not trying to turn you into Rory McIlroy. Like I said about the other girl, it's like she could quit tomorrow. I'm just trying to make you more athletic. Understand that sports fitness is a part of your life. So that's the game there. And then as the game progresses, right, if you lose your balance, you're out. Right? They always ask, this is when you know you're doing a good job. The first question everybody asks, can I keep practicing? Yes, absolutely. Keep practicing. Make the rules progressively harder. Okay, swing and miss, you're out. Ball has to go at least as high as your knees. Stuff like that. Well, what happens is, we take it right out on the golf course, we set it up exactly the same. Ready? So they took a practice swing. Ready, set, go. Same thing. And we play it like a scramble. So, that shot, we go there. Here on par three, same exact thing. So you got one ball on the green and you've got five or six balls short. So, skills development, swing instruction, they complement each other. It's not 95% one, 5% the other. Awareness of natural movement patterns. Like I was saying, hey, if she's hitting good shots, leaning back, you can always fix it a little bit later. Technology is a tool for the teacher, guide for the student. I know sometimes that's some of the debate. TrackMan's ruining golfers, technology's ruining golfers and stuff like that. It's how we use it. That's a tool for us, right? This is a big one, right? We're always thinking about success. So one of the things I always talk to my kids about, all of the juniors, especially the ones that are a little bit more focused about it, serious, is that this game is not designed for success. This game is designed for failure. The game is meant for you to fail. Like, have you seen the Robin Williams bit? I'm gonna put a hole right here. To give you hope, that skit, right? It's about failing, not about succeeding. So the good player understands that they fail and maneuvers around it, deals with it, right? So the guy that wins or the girl that wins the tournament is the one that failed the least. Or understood what their failures were. And once you understand that, and understand that when you hit a bad shot, what did I learn from that? What did I do? Well, you did this. Did we work on that? Yeah. So what did we work on? Oh, I was supposed to do this. Do you think you did it there? Nah, probably not. Okay, let's try it again. Just like that. Also, the sense of perfection. You've probably heard this analogy, writing your signature over and over again. If you write your name 100 times, are they going to look exactly the same? Of course not. They're each going to be different. But they're all going to look like your signature, and they're all going to be legible. And once in a while, we screw up, right? I write an M instead of an N, something like that. But it's still my name. Well, that's so when you make a bad swing, it's not that different from all of the others. So for us, it's ears open, watch the eyes. What are the kids saying? Listen to it. A lot of times for our sessions, especially in school season, spring, fall, and now I do some winter programs, is one of the first questions I ask them is, hey, how is school today? Because chances are they're coming to you right from school. And the parents are too busy, oh, traffic, gonna be late, damn it, oh, I gotta pick up your sister, and gotta send her to da-da-da-da. Hey, how was school today? It was okay. Yeah. Lunch good? Yeah. Did you have your favorite lunch again? Mac and cheese?
Yeah.
Was it good this time?
Yeah.
Okay. A little tired? You okay?
Yeah, I'm good.
And then they're kind of walking in, they hit a shot, and they're like, ah, you know what that's a sign of? You didn't have enough mac and cheese, you're a little tired, didn't have enough energy. You don't have enough energy. So you remember this. So it's like Kirk was asking earlier. It's not just for kids. So as Michael was talking about with Operation 36, you could do this with adults. You're doing this with them as well.
Do you do the same thing with adults where, you know, if they're hitting it pretty good off their back foot, you know, and they're not following like the standard setup protocol, just kind of let it go like the kids, or do you get in there differently?
I'll let it go, but I'll also say, do me a favor, right, is see if you can stand a little bit more flat-footed. I don't even tell them to go there. So just stand a little bit more flat-footed. Okay. Sometimes what happens is like when they stand flat-footed, they'll come up to you 10 minutes later and say, yeah, you know what, I noticed that. Yeah, the flat-footed was actually a little bit better, right? But actually, I discovered that if I get over here, I actually did it even better. So is that all right if I did that?
Oh, yeah.
That's pretty good. The ones that take lessons from you, you're probably being a little bit more technical because you probably worked on it in the lesson. Okay, John, don't forget, you're working on staying a little bit more on your left. We'll take a little break now. I just got a couple other things to bring up. And good to go. If you're looking at improving your teaching and coaching skills like seminars, these are the three that I would recommend, the U.S. Kids Golf Seminars. You get a bunch of information from them. Games that focus on specific skills development. Titleist Performance Institute Junior Coaching Track is very good. It's expensive, but it's worth it if you're willing to do that. And Dr. Rick Jensen and Henry Brunton, Certified Golf Coaching, they have a good program as well. In fact, if you go down to, who's going to the PGA show? Right, if you have the time, all three of them are running something down there. So it's something for you to look up if you have time for it. Now, just an example of using a training aid and a tool. So here's Madison again. So she's hitting a pitch shot. So this is how I'm using training aids and technology. So she's staying on the body track. I'm just asking her to hit a pitch shot. And so she's actually, I know it's hard for you to see, she's about 65% on her rear foot. So this goes to what we were talking about earlier about now fixing it. So she thought she was on her lead side. So the leaderboard is kind of giving her awareness. So you'll see how the front one is shaking a lot. So what she thought she was doing is not what she's really doing. So now she's getting a little bit better at it. And what you'll also notice is in the beginning when she was on the leaderboard, she was translating way off the ball. Or in her practice swings, now she's suddenly moving this way. Just give her a club back. Can you make swings this way? See, you see her going like this? I didn't say a word. She knows now. Well, now she's 60% on her left. You notice that, I don't know if you can see it, but the dot doesn't move nearly as extremely to the right and then back. So she's a little bit more stable on the left. So you can see the difference right there.
She was 86 trailing.
Yeah.
No pressure.
Can you use that body track?
Yeah.
James, not to get off topic, but we have that swell. Obviously, you know what the numbers can be in the brain. Have you found anything that kind of said, like, 4 hours or this? Is there a resource there?
I don't think
it's, there's proof right now and data about the bell curve of pressure, where they talk about, okay, how many percent, even in the golf swing, where tour average is. The standard deviation is 15 degrees on either side. So if you're trying to base instruction on tour average, when the standard deviation could be, let's say you're on your leaf at 80, tour place could be 65 and 95, then that's very misleading. So I wouldn't use tour average or anything with pressure, because it's only telling you where the sum of the pressure is. It's not really telling you where your mass is. Just a guide.
So I use the leaderboard a lot just because gives them more awareness of what their feet are doing. I know one of the things that's talked about in general is how the younger generations now are coming out, they're not as athletic, they're more sitting on their couches with their iPhones and their iPads playing video games, so they're not as athletic, they're not as aware of themselves. And so what happens is, like you saw in the video of Madison, is that she thought she was doing one thing and she was actually doing something completely different. So I like devices like this that really kind of wake you up and show you things. So, and what's great about this training aid, for instance, is that it's non-denominational in terms of what you teach. If you're a stack and tilt teacher, you can do that if you want. You can even go the other way and think of it as like, well, I'm stack and tilt, so I want to do this. If you're someone that likes to get their player to move a lot, okay, no problem. You can do anything you want. You can do short game like you saw there. You want your player to be more centered, working on certain things like this. So you can think of a million things. Now, they don't make this anymore. And if you happen to find one on eBay, it's probably going to be astronomically priced. So the next best thing is just getting a bow slide or a furniture slider. You can do the exact same thing. Right? You can work on the same things. I would just suggest you have something there that will block them, otherwise it'll be right there. They could pull a muscle. So just some border there. So that's that. There's DaVinci training aids. I like these because they're simple to attach, they're simple to use. I don't know how many of you have taught with the alignment stick attached to the club, stuff like this, right? Sometimes the players have difficulty holding both the club and the alignment stick in their hand, and they're click, 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 or they get their fingers, their skin squeezed in between, right? So what happens is they have an attachment which is just there, goes on the end of the club like this. It's the exact same thing, much easier. So this is something to look at. Some of you may have seen rope swinging drills. There's rope there. The blue and white ones for little kids. The white ones for bigger kids or adults. And you know, just some of the things that we do here. It's pretty simple.
Can you explain what the ropes do and how you utilize them?
Yeah, I like using the ropes because it gives you a sense of what the player is doing in terms of implementing, sound really scientific, what kind of forces they're implementing in the downswing. And like, for me, I focus a lot on what's going here. Right, so we get a lot of casters, right, early releasers. So what happens is, can you see it here? Some of you might be able to see it, some of you might not be able to see it. But if you took out your iPhone or if you have like a really good camera and you videotaped it, what you would have seen is this. And then, so what happens is you can really see it. It's something that you can't see with a golf club. So seeing it in the rope, also what happens when the player does it is this. They hit themselves. So what you're teaching them is how to delay that a little bit. Not holding the angle, just a better understanding of where that force is applied and how it's applied. So it might be as simple as this. Hey, where do you feel the rope and your arms are straightening out? Well, I feel like it's straightening out there. Okay, can you make the same swing straightening it out in front of you? So the first couple will be like this. Ow. Ow. No, I want you to swing it out there. Feel like you're swinging at her. Oh, so I feel like I'm doing it here now. Is that what you want? Yeah, that's what I want. Pretty simple.
Make that require.
Home Depot. Lowe's.
Okay.
And you notice how I doubled up the rope just for a little bit more heft? How long it should be? About the length of a 6-iron. 6 or 7-iron. So any questions?
Your spring and fall programs, when do you run them? Weekdays, what time, weekends?
The spring and fall ones, I run them all 7 days of the week. So what happens is we have the luxury to offer it like that. So the interesting thing is, I noticed there was a trend in this area, which is no one signs up for Wednesday. It could be religious schools, activities, stuff like that. So no one signed up for Wednesday. So we were getting filled up Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. So we're always looking for, especially this golf course, because it's owned by the town, so it's a revenue generator. So one of the things that we offered was a free Wednesday practice for anybody that wanted to come. Meaning, you're signing up for your particular day. I'm going to come every Tuesday, but you're also welcome to come on Wednesday for a free practice if you want. It's supervised. Just let me know you're coming. All of a sudden, the Wednesday is filled up because everybody thinks it's free. But in actuality, it's priced in. So what happens is the instructors that are working that day to oversee the practice, they're getting paid their rate. So it all works out. So I know Michael was talking a little bit about the hourly rates. So with the group programs that we're doing, yeah, you can get as much as double, 3 times your normal hourly rate, depending on what you charge for a private lesson. The other thing this does, you probably all experience this, like you get the junior who's coming for their first lesson, and they're just kind of like, they were dragged there, or they're not really into it. When is this over? What time is it? You get those kind of telltale signs, but what happens is we flip-flop. So that the kids are all starting in this big program, they're having fun, they're getting what they want. And so what happens is as they get more serious about it, now they want the lesson. Can I get a lesson? I really want a lesson. My kid really wants a lesson. So it starts to funnel down into your lesson schedule. Now the kids are showing up, they're engaged because they want to be there. They're not being forced. They couldn't wait all week. So they're ready. Plus they like you already because you were doing the group. In fact, they probably asked, can I have a lesson with Dale? So now he shows up, she shows up. She wants to be there. Likewise, you start to develop them and then you get them into higher levels of play, competition, high school golf, local junior tours. Maybe you get lucky and you get two or three or four, and they're really highly developed, and you're thinking about colleges, right? It's all going this way, right? A funnel effect. The great thing that I like is that my program, I guess you could say I have about maybe 10 kids who you would say are elite competitive players. They play in AJGA or something like that. I don't take players from other teachers. That's your student. All of my players in the higher levels all came through the program. They graduated from school. If someone comes to me that's from another teacher, it's just because their teacher's not around anymore. They moved somewhere else. What I like to do is I say, well, you're really good. Why are you coming here? Well, we heard about you. Believe me, if your teacher made you like that, there ain't nothing I can do that'll make you better. Go back to whatever you're doing because that's pretty good. So I think what you'll find is if you have a program like that, people will see that, oh wow, there's a developmental process to this. And you as the instructor, you as the golf school look very organized. So does that make sense to everyone? Any other questions?
Your summer program, is it different from like your par program, spring, summer, fall?
Yeah, it's a little bit more different. It's a little bit more golf oriented, more serious.
Put everybody together.
Yeah. So the summer camps, the regular summer camps are the par programs.
Are the par programs.
Par programs. And then what happens is the birdie program, which is sort of like beginner intermediate, they're starting to like it a little bit more. They want to be a little bit more involved. They run all year round. So the spring, you were asking about the spring and the fall programs, it runs like spring, summer, fall, winter.
So you would get any, like your birdie kids want to come for the full day program camp during the summer?
They do, but I think they'll, it's very rare that they stick with it. Like, wow, I didn't realize it was this difficult. So usually it's the kids that are really serious. They wonder, like the advanced programs are all 2 to 6. So they might ask, like, can we come at like 12 and just kind of play a couple of holes, or can we go and practice on it? Yeah, sure, no problem. Any other questions? Hope I helped you guys out, ladies out.
Janice, thank you very much. It's great information. So if there's anything you can take away from today is that we don't really have to at all our facilities because of how unique each of your facilities are to implement Operation 36 or do an elaborate program like James Hong has here and Lois and other assistants here at Teaching Professionals Harvard Links. It's really if you can just implement something of value so that you can adapt your junior program a little bit and maybe you could evolve a little bit so that you can help grow the game a little bit or you can help create a little bit more revenue at facilities. I think just anything that you can take away from these presentations can only benefit you. So thank you so much for coming.